Good morning.
Good morning. May it please the court, my name is Jillian Kyrus, and I represent the Coeur d'Alene Tribe. I would like to reserve 2 minutes for my rebuttal.
All right.
The judgment of the district court must be reversed because the tribe's petition seeking recognition of the tribal court judgment presents a federal question. This court already decided this issue in Wilson v. Marshington when it affirmed the legal conclusions of the district court reached in that case.
Well, okay, you're really jumping to the crux. Since we don't have a lot of time, you seem to say it has decided, but we didn't decide it couldn't be argued that we didn't decide the precise question of federal court subject matter jurisdiction that's presented here. Do you agree with that?
Your Honor, I agree that it was not explicitly addressed, but I would direct you to the second to last sentence of that opinion where the court stated that it agreed with the substance of the district court's conclusion, but ironically, it did reverse on the merits analysis that it did under comedy.
Well, but can you point to us where in Marshington the court actually considered and decided the issue of federal court subject matter jurisdiction?
Your Honor, those words are never explicitly stated in the case. They are explicitly stated by the district court, but in the Ninth Circuit case, the court recognized that there are important federal issues and that there are threshold questions every time a tribal court judgment comes before the court under a comedy analysis. And so part of that is the due process and the subject matter jurisdiction of the tribal court. And why it's important.
The existence of federal issues buried in a case doesn't automatically qualify for federal question jurisdiction. The Supreme Court's spoken clearly with regard to federal defenses. And so what is it that opens the door of the federal courthouse? What is it in this case?
In this case, part of it is the important policies supporting federal Indian law.
Well, what in the complaint states a federal question?
In our complaint?
Mm-hmm.
Our complaint, it cites reliance upon National Farmers versus Crow Tribe and Wilson v. Marshington. So our reliance upon the precedent of the United States Supreme Court and the Ninth Circuit present the federal question. And important policy considerations support that federal question jurisdiction should be found in this case. But tribal courts are creatures of federal statute. The federal law has permitted tribes to operate their own courts of limited jurisdiction, and only the federal laws can carve out what the jurisdiction of those courts are. Tribes, as this court knows, are dependent sovereign nations. And in any matter where, if this was left to a state decision, there are always inherent tensions between states and tribes at issue.
Is there any reason to think the state court wouldn't recognize the tribal judgment?
At this point, as far as the state of Idaho goes, tribal court judgments are recognized under comity, but there's no obligation in the state that it remains that way. And
a federal court, I mean, our rule of decision in Marshington, it says it's comity. That's not required under full faith and credit, so I don't see the difference. I mean, I confess there must be something in the background here because I can't figure out why this case has paused so long on our doorstep. I mean, if the interest was in enforcing the judgment rapidly, this detour through the issue of federal jurisdiction has taken a whole lot of time. So why is it the federal court should take this kind of case on?
And again, that goes to the unique federal interests of tribal courts and tribal court judgments. There is a necessity that there be consistency in treatment of tribal court judgments, and under the current, if there is not a federal question for recognition of a tribal court judgment in federal courts, it's left to the states, and it's inconsistent how tribal court judgments are treated throughout the states.
Federal courts can be plenty inconsistent in and of themselves, so I'm not sure that really gives me a policy-type reason. And granted, I'm looking for a reason. Why should the federal courts get engaged in this kind of issue?
Part of the reason for that is that if it's left in the states, it then is up to the state to determine what is the scope of a tribal court's jurisdiction. And so every time a tribe brings a judgment for recognition in the state court, then it's up to that state court to determine the scope of whether or not the tribe was properly acting. And that is a question that can only be answered with reference to the federal laws and federal treaties and statutes between the United States and the tribes. And the United States, as a trustee, owes a fiduciary duty to the tribes. Again, the federal government has given tribes the power to operate these courts of limited jurisdiction, but that power can be further limited or expanded by the federal government. So leaving it to states to determine whether or not a tribal court was properly acting within its jurisdiction, it becomes a very dangerous territory for the overall credibility of tribal courts.
Let me ask you a question. So you've assumed that Marchinson and Byrd both find that there is subject matter jurisdiction. But let's assume that they didn't. They didn't make such a finding. The 11th Circuit has, on the other hand, said that there is no federal subject matter jurisdiction. So why should we not follow the Miccosukee tribe case?
Your Honor, in Miccosukee, the 11th Circuit in their footnote 12 indicated that they were making that decision based upon their interpretation of National Farmers Insurance versus Crow Tribe. And in National Farmers, the United States Supreme Court recognized that Indian tribes occupy unique status under our law, and that the extent of a tribal court jurisdiction always requires careful examination of federal laws and treaties. Judge Wimmill, in his decision, stated that if the Hawks had brought this action, that there would be a federal question, and that's consistent with Miccosukee. That is what was stated. And in part, that's because jurisdiction in Miccosukee wasn't challenged by the defendant. But under the well-pleaded complaint rule, it wouldn't matter in this case whether or not the defendant had challenged the jurisdiction, had they ever filed an answer, because the federal question must come from the complaint.
What is the federal question in the complaint in this case?
So the federal question, ultimately boiled down, is that, as we propose, should be whether or not the tribal court judgment is entitled to recognition under comity. We argue that that should be the federal question pursuant to Wilson v. Marchington, ultimately. And part of the reason for that is that, again, a threshold inquiry, just as in the case of had the Hawks brought this matter challenging jurisdiction, ultimately, under National Farmers and under Wilson v. Marchington in the comity analysis, the district court always must consider whether or not there was subject matter and personal jurisdiction over a non-tribal member. So it does not, even if the parties stipulate, the district court still has an obligation to consider that issue.
Your
position is that any time that a tribe wishes to domesticate a judgment from a tribal court, by its very nature, the federal courts have subject matter jurisdiction. Is that what I'm hearing?
And Your Honor, I would say any time a tribe seeks to domesticate a judgment against a non-tribal member, but that's not what we're asking this court necessarily to find. We're asking for a narrow relief here to find that recognition of this judgment presents a federal question. And with that,
how can we draw that distinction? I mean, you're trying to tell us we don't have to wrap arms around a big principle, but to rule in an individual case, it seems to me we have to wrap our arms around that principle. Is there something distinct about this case so we can say it's a one-off?
A distinction in this case is that rather than involving something like a contract, like Miccosukee, this case involves federally held trust lands that are held for the benefit of the tribe and an order from the tribal court seeking to evict a non-tribal member from trespassing upon those.
Well, in my view, I don't think we can look at this as a one-off. You know, obviously everyone wants to come in and win, but this is it's a national issue, and we have to look at first, does Marchington, is that our precedent? If it is our precedent, then we either have to go sua sponte en banc or wait to be, you know, we have to follow our precedent if we decide it's our precedent. If we feel that it gives us room, then we have to look at Miccosukee. We have to look at that, and then we have to decide, do we want to go with the 11th Circuit? Do we have a split with the 11th Circuit? I mean, this is a national issue. So when you say, just let me win, we can't just let you win. We have to decide this case with a broader brush.
And, Your Honor, I see that I am out of time.
Yeah, I'm just telling you, and I'll give you, as I said, I think it's our time. So I'll give you a minute for a rebuttal.
Okay. Thank you.
Unless you want to tell me that we shouldn't think bigger than your case when we think it has national implications.
I don't.
Thanks. Good morning.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please the court, my name is Norm Samanka with the firm of Parsons Bailey in Boise, Idaho, and we represent Steve and Deanne Hawks in this matter.
So why don't you just jump in on what we're seeing? You know, there's not a lot. We know the specifics. And so how can we square the district court's ruling with our holding in Marchington that the existence of the tribal court subject matter jurisdiction is a threshold inquiry in virtually every federal examination of tribal judgment, and this is a threshold inquiry, and this threshold inquiry is determined under federal common law. So how do we square the district court's ruling with our holding in Marchington?
Yes, Your Honor, I'm pleased to do that. I think the answer lies in the learned district court judge's analysis. He looks directly at National Farmers Union Insurance Company, which of course is the binding United States Supreme Court case, and he says that in that case, where the defendant in the tribal court brought an action seeking to enjoin the tribal court from enforcing its own judgment, that there was a federal question. There was an actual concrete controversy over tribal court jurisdiction. And he sees that we don't have that in this case. Marchington didn't have that in that case, so he then looks for persuasive authority, of course, in the Miccosukee case where there was no controversy, and looking at the exact language from National Farmers Union, this case does not involve a dispute over the tribal court's jurisdiction. What the tribe asks is that the federal district court domesticate the judgment so that it can obtain execution of the judgment.
But you seem to agree that there would be subject matter jurisdiction if the Hawks had filed an action in federal court challenging the validity of a tribal court judgment. Why should it be otherwise if the tribe seeking a federal court determination that the tribal court judgment is valid? I mean, there's already enough trouble here. So,
yes, Your Honor, one of the
first... It just doesn't seem to, you know, we think bigger than just this case.
Yes, Your Honor, I understand. And one of the first things that Judge Windmill noted in his decision is that the tribe is also pursuing the same relief in the Idaho State Courts. So the Idaho State Courts have jurisdiction. In fact, one of the related cases that's cited in both briefs, opening briefs for both sides, is the Johnson case, which was decided last year by the Idaho Supreme Court and is noted in the related cases description on remand to the district court for entry of a judgment, which has since occurred. So, yes, I agree that if there was a challenge to the jurisdiction of the tribal court, that raises a federal question. That's very clear under the national tax insurance case. But we don't have that set of facts here. We don't have a challenge.
Do we have it implicitly? I mean, the Supreme Court has said that jurisdiction is a threshold question. The parties can't stipulate to it. If it doesn't get raised, the court may go on and not pay attention to it. But it's inherently planted in every case. Could it be argued, indeed it has been argued, that simply by bringing this case, the tribe has done what Judge Windmill suggested in terms of, suppose the tribe had sought a declaratory judgment, could it be said, well, they sort of have, because they brought this case to try to domesticate the judgment. That, by implication, means an assertion that there is federal court jurisdiction, and that's a question that gets resolved under a federal common law.
Yes, Your Honor, great question. And we all know that there are a number of boxes that have to be checked questions that are assumed to be answered as the case moves forward. But unless the question is actually presented to the court, and that's what Judge Windmill was saying, reluctantly, I think was the word he used. He said he's compelled to grant the motion to dismiss. There is no federal question presented. It is just like the Miccosukee case, which, while not binding on this court, was looking directly at the United States Supreme Court precedent and said, we can't simply recognize a tribal judgment just because you're placing it in front of us. There must be some kind of actual concrete controversy.
Well, let me ask you this. Okay, if instead of bringing the action in tribal court, the tribe had sued in federal district court seeking to enforce its tribal ordinance against the Hawks, would the court have had subject matter jurisdiction?
Your Honor, as I understand the hypothetical you're presenting, yes, because there would be an actual controversy, an actual question in front of the court as to whether or not the tribal court had jurisdiction over the matter in question.
But then it would seem anomalous to hold that the district court lacks subject matter jurisdiction over a case to domesticate a tribal court judgment when the district court would have had subject matter jurisdiction if the underlying action had been brought in federal court. Why is that seemingly anomalous result the correct result here?
Your Honor, again, there is no actual federal question that's been raised in this case. Under your hypothetical, certainly there is. But in this actual current case, there's been no federal question stated. That's what Judge Windmill found. He's correct. It is, as he said, squarely within the posture of the Miccosukee case. It's not similar to the cases cited by learned counsel on the other side. So again, there is a tribal court judgment here. That's not an issue as to whether or not that judgment had underlying subject matter jurisdiction or any other kind of jurisdictional issues. That's just not been challenged.
Well, what?
Why are we here then? I mean, there's got to be something else going on that I haven't seen. What's the problem? If your client doesn't contest the tribal court jurisdiction, what's left to fight over?
Your Honor, I wish I knew the answer to that question. We have seen the tribe go to state district court before, as is noted in Judge Windmill's decision, before the federal court, and that case proceeded and a judgment was obtained, recognized by the district court in the state of Idaho. So we're not quite sure why we're here. We also, you know, note from the U.S. Supreme Court precedent from the National Farmers Union Insurance case that the whole issue there was enforcement of a tribal judgment, execution of a writ, going into the school district, into the school, and seizing computers. We don't see that here.
Your client filed the motion to dismiss in district court. Why?
Your Honor, we filed a motion to dismiss because there simply is no federal question. There is no subject matter jurisdiction.
But
in this
why?
Case.
I mean, it costs money to file a motion to dismiss. If your clients aren't, in fact, contesting the jurisdiction of the tribal court, there must be some other reason why they think by going to state court they're going to get a better result. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense to file the motion to dismiss and go to that expense and to fight it here. I mean, I know this is more than, what, $3,500 or $3,900. There's an eviction order, too. But the cost of the proceeding is wildly in excess of the amount of the civil penalty. So why is it your clients didn't want to be in federal court?
Your Honor, there had already been a tribal court judgment issued. As the opposing counsel has noted in briefing, our client showed up for the first time in federal district court. When a complaint was filed in federal district court, our clients came to us and said, what do we do about this? We looked at it and we said, we don't see what the actual case and controversy is. We don't see what the subject matter jurisdiction is. So
they should spend thousands of dollars resisting the federal court action, but if in the end they don't object to tribal court jurisdiction, what difference is it going to make?
Your Honor, without getting into attorney-client privileged information, I will tell you that the Johnson case, which is cited as a related case, is on the same river. It's just upriver from this location. The community that's along the river on the reservation is very concerned about this, so you can see where I'm going in terms of how a case of this type would be funded, and particularly with an attorney who grew up in the area.
Well, do you see, I guess that part of that's like we say, there's the little picture, then there's the big picture. And every time people, and we have a number of cases about jurisdiction today. And so then the issue becomes, it's like if you divide and conquer, everyone makes an argument in different courts that there's no jurisdiction. There has to be jurisdiction for a dispute somewhere. Okay, but if you go in, if everyone goes in front of different judges and every judge says there's no jurisdiction, essentially you come up with, that can't be the right answer. So then you're here and we're looking at it and saying, okay, we have Marchington. We have to decide what sort of tension, if Marchington controls, we can't go against that. But then, I mean, we have like say for assuming we determine we can't affirm the district court without conflicting with our own precedent, should we take this case on bonk to decide whether we should adopt the 11th Circuit? Because we can go on bonk and say what Marchington said, what it didn't say, and where we want to be on this. And if we want to go with the 11th Circuit, then there's not a split. If we want to say otherwise, then there is a split. Then eventually the Supreme Court will say where all of this goes. Is that...
Your
Honor, I mean, there has to be somewhere all of this goes. But as long as people are going to different courts and everyone says there's no jurisdiction, arguably there can be, it's not just the $3,900.
Your Honor, you've nailed the question at hand, and so did Judge Windmill. Again, he said the tribe is pursuing the same relief in Idaho state courts. And then more importantly, he says on page 2 of his decision, while such a claim has a basis in Idaho law and can be enforced in Idaho courts pursuant to Idaho Code Section 10-1401, the tribe cites no federal statute or law that is in dispute and that could be used to create a federal question. You've already heard here this morning from opposing counsel that tribal court judgment of the Coeur d'Alene tribe has been recognized in Idaho courts recently, that related case that's cited in the briefing, the Johnson case, and there has been a judgment entered against the Johnsons under state law, the analysis under Marchington. So there is a place, it's occurring, and I'm not sure why we're in multiple courts, but I guess this is part of the process to sort all that out. Thank you.
I'll borrow a little more time. I've read in other contexts, and this is specifically not a reference to Idaho, I've read in other contexts of concern about what I'll call state court reluctance to enforce or hostility toward judgments of tribal courts, relationships between states and tribes vary enormously across the country. I know nothing about Idaho, so I want to make it clear. I'm not trying to say anything about Idaho. But is there, from the perspective of your client or people in the position of your client, is there a reason to believe that they will fare better in Idaho court, state court, than they will in federal district court?
Your Honor, it's a great question. So far, at least, they have, and certainly learned opposing counsel can address this question as well, but I don't think that the Coeur d'Alene tribe would suggest that their judgments have not been recognized in the Idaho courts, and I don't want to cite cases not in the record, but the Shepherd case going clear back to 1982 in Idaho, back then it was full faith and credit. In the Johnson case more recently, the related case that's cited, they've decided it's comity, and they looked at Wilson versus Marchington and thought that question of comity versus full faith and credit, we're going to come down there. And they applied that and recognized the judgment, and it was remanded. So I would pose that question to opposing counsel as well. But yes, we see those judgments recognized in Idaho when they're brought, to my knowledge.
Thank you for your argument. You have 1 minute, but if Judge Clifton, do you want to pose your question?
Same question. And it's really the same question we started with. Why are we here? And there's got to be a reason. I haven't figured it out.
Your Honor, I agree with you that there is a risk that tribes will be treated differently among different states and even among different counties within a state. The state of Idaho just recently overturned a 1987 case that recognized tribal judgments under full faith and credit and decided instead that comity applies. But the state of Idaho is under no obligation to recognize a tribal court judgment. And frequently, politics do come into play when it comes to recognizing tribal courts and tribes generally, because they are a competing sovereign nation with the state. They have competing interests. They have competing interests over control of lands.
So if we were to generalize, tribes think they're better off in federal court, and non-Native Americans think they're better off in state court?
I don't know that I would go that far, but I would say that tribes believe, or in our case, we believe, that there is a greater likelihood of consistency in treatment in the federal courts than there is among the states.
Okay. I think, does that answer everyone's questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank
both
you.
For your arguments. This matter will stand submitted.